The mammy, the pickaninny, the coon, the sambo, the uncle. Well into the middle of the 20th century, these were some of the most popular depictions of black Americans.
She rubbed and rubbed her knuckles, rolled them down to the nub, yeah.
By 1941, when this cartoon was made, images like these permeated American culture.
When you see hundreds of them in all parts of the country persisting over a very long period of time, they have to have meaning. They obviously appeal to people. They appeal to the creator, but they appeal also to the consumers, those who read look at the cartoons or read the novels or buy the artifacts.
It's not just that it's in the figurines and in the, you know, the coffee pots and so on. It is that we are seen that way, perceived that way, even in terms of public policy. And that our lives are lived under that shadow. And sometimes we then even become to believe it ourselves.
When Good Times debuted, I was happy to do it. Because I had long wished to redeem the image of the domestic worker.
Good times,
scratching and surviving.
Good times.
I looked at the first script. I said, well, where's these children's father? Where's my husband? There is none. Oh, no, it wasn't written for that. It was written for you and your three children. I said, then you find the actress who can do it. I'm sure there are some who can do it. I can't. Because I insisted, I got a husband.
How long we been married?
Getting on towards 21 years now.
That's right. And we had a lot of arguments in them 21 years, right?
Yeah, we're having a pretty good one right now.
Good Times was the first primetime series to feature a black family with both mother and father. In contrast to the integrationist shows of the 60s, Good Times was set in the heart of Chicago's black South Side community.
I mean, we are poor. And if you was to make a list of all the things that people want to be, poor would be right down at the bottom of the list, just above sick and dead.
Good Times represented the greatest potential and also, in my opinion, the greatest failure. It had the greatest potential because it was an inner-city family that was nuclear, that was solid. They would talk about real-world issues and how an actual black family deals with those real-world issues of racism and economic discrimination. But what happened?
Dynamite!
They elevated JJ's role, which had been one of amusing and sometimes sophisticated comedy, to that of a buffoon.
His humor was tied to a long tradition of the kind of minstrel character. JJ's function in it was essentially to deflate, to let off a lot of the buildup in the particular issues that the show tried to address. I mean, I thought it was a very, in retrospect particularly, a very clever use of a character to rob the show of the kind of political bite that it might have.
Because of the likelihood that you could die at this moment, AIDS forces you to deal with that and to look around you and say, hey, I'm wasting my time if I'm not devoting every moment to thinking about how can I communicate to black people so that we start to look at each other, we start to see each other,
My black is and black ain't. Black is and black ain't. Black is blue and black is red. And black is a tan.
Black will get you.
And black is light.
And black will leave you alone. Black can get you over. And black can set you down. Black can let you move forward, and black will make you stumble around.
It's so hot, and black is so low. Black can say yes, and black
can be your best friend, be cozy as the night. Black can do you in, make you fuss and cuss.
Black is black, and black is blue. Black is bright, black is you. Black music.
What's it all about?
What's it all about? These are the profiles of black musical composers who have maintained the highest standards throughout the years. They have brought us from slavery. Swing low, sweet chariot. Ba-dum, dum, dum, ba-dum, boom, boom. Ba-dum, boom, ba-dum. I woke up this morning with my mind still. My baby's gone and don't know what to do. Shum. Turn this mother out. We're gonna turn this mother.
What's the sign for cut?
I think all black people have to reconcile themselves to each other, to our differences.
And we have to get over the notion that you can only be unified as a people as long as everybody agrees. You know, we don't achieve freedom by those means.
Well, one, we've got to conceive of new forms of community, that we have multiple identities and we're moving out of various communities all at the same time. There's no one grand black community.
It seems to me that we would do well as black folks to replace the notion of unity with the notion of communion. The root meaning of it would suggest that our union is fundamentally based on a notion that we must be willing and able to communicate with one another. Because I think that so often when black folks evoke unity, again, it's the flattening out of differences, the sweeping certain things under the rug so that we can appear to be alike, that we hold one stand, that we have one position. I think communion and its connection to the notion of community might give us greater strength and possibility.
Brother to brother, 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 brother to brother. Brother to brother, 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 brother to brother.
Mother, do you know I roam alone at night, wearing colognes, tight pants, chains of gold, searching for men willing to come back to candlelight, I'm not scared of these men, though some are killers of sons like me. I learned there is no tender mercy for men of color, for sons who love men like me. Do not feel shame for how I live. I chose this tribe of warriors and outlaws. Do not feel you failed some test of motherhood. My life has borne fruit. No woman could have given me anyway. If one of these thick-lipped, wet, black nights, while I'm out walking, I find freedom in this village. If I can take it with my tribe, I'll bring you here, and you will never notice the absence of rice and bridesmaids.
Whatever awaits me, this much I know. I was blind to my brother's beauty, and now I see my own. Deaf to the voice that believed we were worth wanting, loving each other, now I hear. I was mute, tongue-tied, burdened by shadows and silence. Now I speak, and my burden is lightened, lifted, free.